Ksheerasaagara Mathanam. The gods were having a bad time. They were frequently attacked and killed by the demons, and their strength decreased. Indra, along with the survivors among the gods, approached Brahma and explained their fate. Brahma told them that it was all due to the pride and arrogance of Indra, and that he could not help them. He took them all to Lord Vishnu. Brahma began to praise the Lord, and then the gods explained their distress. The Lord heard them patiently and advised them that till all the gods had tasted nectar, amritam, they would be having such troubles. He would show them the way for it. Until then, they should have patience. Meanwhile, they should court the friendship of and live amicably with the demons. The way to obtain amritam was that all medicinal herbs should be brought and thrown into the ocean of milk, and the ocean must be churned with a mountain called Mantara, using snake Vasuki as rope. The Lord would be there to help them when necessary. But out of their efforts, a deadly poison, Halahala, would be springing forth as a byproduct. It would be capable of destroying the whole earth. They must not be afraid of it. They must escape it and continue to churn the ocean till nectar was obtained. So the gods made truce with the demons and behaved and lived as true cousins, addressing each other with sweet words. They mooted the idea of obtaining nectar with the demons, and they also agreed. Many herbs were brought and thrown into the ocean of milk. They altogether lifted the Mantara mountain in order to take it to the ocean. On the way, it slipped and many were crushed under its weight. They got afraid, but soon Lord Vishnu arrived there on Garuda, and Garuda easily lifted the mountain with his claws and placed it in the ocean and went away. Vasuki was approached and coaxed to accept the place of the churning rope, and he was promised his share of the nectar when obtained. He agreed. He was wound round the mountain. The gods held his head portion. The demons protested on account of the influence of the Lord's Maya, that they were not so mean as to catch the tail and wanted only the head portion containing the venom. The gods, with relief, took up the tail portion and the churning began. Slowly, the mountain began to sink on account of its own weight. Lord Vishnu immediately became a tortoise, entered the ocean, went under the mountain and supported it on his back. The churning started again in earnest. Very soon, a deadly poison, Halahala, came out. It was so fierce that it appeared to burn the whole earth. The gods beseeched Lord Shiva for protection. Shiva replied that rulers were there only to protect the subjects when they besieged them for fear of life. After all, life was transitory. To serve the living creatures was the greatest duty. The Supreme would be pleased by such acts. He conveyed his agreement to his spouse, Goddess Bhavani, and she said, "May it be as you desire." When Parikshit heard this, he was astonished and said to Shuka, "O sage, the gods in distress may request Shiva to take the poison. Shiva, out of compassion, may agree. But how did Uma consent to her husband taking the deadly poison?" The sage replied, "Uma knew fully well that he who was to drink the poison was the Lord. He was only removing a calamity of the living creatures and doing Loka Kalyana. She was fully confident that the Lord would not suffer any harm out of the poison." Lord Shiva swallowed the poison as if it were some fruit juice without any discomfort and retained it in his throat. He did not allow it to go into the stomach where dwelt all the living creatures. So he became Nilakanta, the blue-necked lord. The gods and demons felt a great relief and recommended churning the ocean, and out of their efforts many byproducts came out, besides the Halahala. They were Kamadenu, Ucheshrava, Airavata, Kaustubha, Parijata, Kalpataru, Apsaras, the moon, goddess Lakshmi, Varuni and Danvantri with the jar of nectar. Kamadenu, the celestial cow, was taken by the sages to help them in performing sacrifices. Ucheshrava, the celestial white horse, was taken by Bali. Airavata, the celestial white elephant with four tusks, was taken by Indra to serve him as his vehicle. Lord Vishnu himself took the jewel Kaustubha. Parijata Kalpataru was planted in a Nandavana, the park of Indra, Nandanavana. Apsaras, the celestial damsels, joined the heaven to make it attractive. The moon occupied the sky to make the nights pleasant. Goddess Lakshmi was of exquisite beauty, grandeur and charm. Nobody could take their eyes off her. Everybody solicited her grace for their prosperity. She began to search for her lord, a husband among the gods and demons. She wanted to search and discover a husband who had no blemish, who had eternal and everlasting supreme virtues. As she went on scanning, she found that some could not control their anger, even though possessed of austerities. There was wisdom in some, but tainted with attachment. Some could not control their sense organs and were running after them. Some were righteous, but had no love for fellow creatures. Some had power, which was but transitory. Some were purely meditative and had no contact with their senses, and there was no place for a lady. Some had all good qualities, but their lives were very short. There was only one, gifted with all everlasting qualities as she wished, but he was indifferent to the fair sex and had no longing for her. Nevertheless, she chose him, Lord Vishnu, and occupied his bosom, which was to be her permanent place. Varuni, the daughter of the ocean god Varuna, was the presiding deity of wine, and the demons took her. Danvantri was a manifestation of the power of Lord Vishnu. He appeared wearing fine ornaments, flower garlands, and yellow dress. He was holding the jar containing the nectar, Amritam. He was the preceptor who taught the science of medicine, Ayurveda, to the world. Seeing the jar of nectar in the hands of Danvantri, the demons snatched it away and began to run. The gods were upset. All their labors became a waste. They ran to the Lord for relief. The Lord pacified them, saying that he would get the nectar back through some maneuver. Very soon, by the influence of the Lord's Maya, the demons began to quarrel among themselves. The stronger one began to snatch the jar from the weaker one, and so it changed hands frequently. The weaker one began to cry aloud that the gods too must get their equal share of the fruits of labor. Meanwhile, the Lord transformed himself into a beautiful maiden called Mohini, finely dressed, exquisitely decorated, and began to move among them. Passion grew in the minds of the demons because of her gestures and smiles. They were completely deluded by her charm, and they handed over the jar of nectar to her with the request to distribute the contents equally to all. She agreed to do so if they would accept whatever was done by her, whether it was right or wrong. They could not say no. She made them sit in two rows, gods on one side and demons on the other side, because she decided that it was dangerous to give the demons any nectar. She began to serve the gods first. Though she was pouring the nectar into the mouths of the gods, her looks were on the demons, cajoling them and promising to come to their line very soon. The demons were looking at her eyes and not the jar. One demon, Rahu, stealthily went and sat among the gods between the sun and the moon and drank the nectar. They both immediately reported the mischief to the Lord, who sent his Sudarshana Chakra, which severed his head. The body fell down, but the head became immortal and began to trouble the sun and the moon as eclipses. This is a philosophical allegory. The gods and demons are the good and bad tendencies and thoughts ever existing in the ocean of milk, the bosom of the seeker. There is perpetual war between them. When the seeker wants to clean his own stock by introspection and tries at meditation in the early stages, all the foul vasanas or demonic thoughts bubble up as the halahala, a poison. These must come out and empty themselves so that the bosom may become pure. Seekers should not be afraid of them because they are all their own accumulated stock of time immemorial. They must try to eject them out. When the mind becomes pure, meditation brings forth many fruits like the gems. The efforts should not be slackened till the nectar, self-realization, is attained. When well established in that state of bliss, all the demons of evil tendencies get routed out as in a battle. For this, there must be constant attempt at obtaining the great of the self, the supreme, who dwells in the cave of the heart. Meanwhile, the nectar in the jar was exhausted and the maiden Mohini also disappeared. The demons got no nectar at all. The gods got the nectar because they always courted the grace of the Lord. The demons never cared to court his grace and so could not have the fruit of their labor. On account of their frustration, the demons began to attack the gods on all sides. In the battle that ensued, all the demons were defeated and many were killed. The survivors took the dead bodies of Bali and others to the ashramam of Shukracharya, their guru, and he brought them back to life. Bali and others accepted defeat for the time being at the hands of the gods and decided to keep quiet as the times were not favorable to them.